Eh? Well, I can't hear you for the traffic, what?
Is it just the one joint that's loose?
Yeah. You'd never believe it, would you?
It's no wonder they were worried about it. Oh, what do you reckon then?
Laugh at
staging
about that.
Round.
Another one over there like that. Lightning conductor fell off as well. You can see straight through it there, daylight. See the train going by.
This is the chimney, Fred. Yeah. Have a boiler in there for a wood burner for heating, yeah, for the central heating of both houses in the garage. And the problem is, there's a copper relief pipe was up the side.
Yeah.
And if lightning should come,
it would blow the lot up.
Yeah.
Well, don't worry about it, because we'll come with some ladders and fix them up and stick your lightning conductor and bury it on the edge of lawn somewhere. You know, it's a bit vulnerable, isn't it? It's dead flat round here. Like, if it did get stuck with lightning, it'd muck it up a bit, you know. I've got some lovely...
We'll go down to the boiler and across through the pipes, the radiator,
I might end up, like, dancing on the 20,000 volts in parlour lights or anything. Yeah, well, we'll put your super lightning conductor on.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, there's no way you're going to get blown out your chair when you're sat in parlour.
Hi, Fred. I know you've been keeping your eye on this chimney for us, and we've not been using it for about 3 years.
Yeah.
But looking at one or two small cracks that we're getting, I think we've got to drop it down before winter.
Barrels of beer in between the iron bands at the top.
Well, we've got birds. We've got birds nesting up there, I think, on the top.
Yeah. For all of it down to the floor, I reckon about £8,000. But it wouldn't be a bad idea just to bring it down to level with the copings and put a concrete plinth around it, you know. Down to the roof with a lid on, £6,500, you know.
I think that's £6,500 as good a score as I've got from anybody, so I think we can go ahead with that.
And that's all shifted and all bunged up and everything, nice neat job. And if you're not satisfied, you've no need to pay me.
Oh, that's very good.
You know, and I'll not do any damage to the top.
I'll certainly let you know if I'm not satisfied.
Like winter's coming, you see.
For me,
this will be a good job for when it's bloody bad weather, you know, because the rain doesn't affect you.
Yeah.
Like if you, yesterday I were up one over there and I bloody pointed round about five letters and washed it all away. So, you know, you sat there in the pouring bloody rain at the bottom and you think about all these buggers with nice jobs, you know. And then I climbed up again and did it again, and bloody hell, it rained again, and all of that got washed away. And then I did it for the third time, and it didn't rain, you know, so that was okay, and had me tea in peace.
Right, Fred?
Yeah, right.
Right, everybody, you've heard on the grapevine that we're knocking the chimney down, which is right. Unfortunately, you can't knock it down like he normally knocks them down and drop them in one piece. So he's actually got to get up there and knock it down brick by brick.
We're not here for catch bricks, are we?
No, Jim, he's actually dropping the bricks down the inside. He'll drop them down the inside and they'll actually come out this hole here. And when they come out, they're all going to be counted. And we're running this competition to find out how many bricks there are in that chimney. I invite you all to actually make a guess, because the one who guesses to the nearest number that we've actually estimated or can count actually when we're actually dismantling it, I'll get a weekend in Paris for two. Any ideas? Percy knows.
21,000.
21,000? 21,000? Top row?
Yeah, a million and a half, I should say. A million and a half up there.
A million and a half.
A million and a half. Easy.
Any more bids?
72,000.
50,000.
Jack's well on.
There's
got to be 2 million at least.
2 million at least. Well,
86,000.
Right, isn't it?
We actually did work out how many bricks there are in the thing, you know, like me and Donald. Like, I got the tape measure out and measured it up in height and width and thickness. And then Donald pondered over the paperwork for about 2 days and come up with this figure that I somehow or other forgotten what it is, you know. 20,000-odd, something like that. You know, it isn't that really important to me because I can't have a go, you know. And a weekend in Paris is no abuse to me, you know. What can I do in Paris? I think the only interesting thing would be climb up the Eiffel Tower, you know. That'd be quite interesting, you know. 900 and some feet high, I think it is, you know. That'd be exciting. I wouldn't mind having to do with that. Mm. The White Cross we're shaking about, we'd fixed that up, we'd point its spire, and we'd put them three sets of cast iron corner plates and iron rods round. And now we've come to them pillars, you know, and they're buggered. They've got, like, big cracks up them from where the iron dowels are in the bottom. You know, I've had a word with the architect, man, and I reckon we should try and, as cheap as we can, get four new ones. I mean, if me and you were up there now, I can, like, pull great lumps out, you know, just with my fingers. And, you know,
there's no danger of me and thee being up there.
No, I know that. Well, no, I don't expect you to climb up there, but I'm not pulling your leg, you know.
No.
They are bad.
But whatever you did, a repair job wouldn't last, would it?
No,
I want a permanent structure.
We couldn't mend them. You could bodge them up with sand and cement, you know. But another bloody 20 years and they'd be as bad as ever. And I don't
Well, I have the authority of the standing committee to proceed with the job.
Yeah. Working round churches is quite nice and peaceful, you know, and at least you're doing something that it has a fair chance of surviving, like, you know, they don't knock them all down. I think some of these Victorians who'd made the money out of spinning mills were paving the way into heaven when they built some of these in the 1870s, you know, like they'd had the skin off the backs of all the lads, like, and, you know, we'll build a nice church. These blokes who built this particular church must have had a hell of a battle because it's made out of local flag rock, which is terrible stuff to chop. It's hard as iron. I know some of them must have had big muscles because, you know, if you get an hammer and chisel and start clouting at a big rock, after an hour or two, you're rather worn, and, you know, they must have done it all day long.
You see, you can just pull these lumps out, you know.
Yeah. The dowels inside have swelled up and busted them. Not a lot we can do with that.
What sort of a job is it, that? Did it like the job?
What?
A lengthy job?
Yeah, not really.
Oh.
What worries me is what's behind, you know.
Yeah.
How the masonry is. I mean, here, there's a great crack you can shove my fingers in. You find all sorts of things up tops of these things. Like on this particular one, there's somebody's initials on one stone, you know, just at the bottom of the spire. I like reading gravestones, you know. There's some very interesting gravestones. I mean, now they don't even bother with that, do they? You know, they shove you in the incinerator and get a little bit of rock with your name on when you were born and when you departed. And after 20-odd years, they throw it away anyway. It's not like it were when we first come up. You can't swing it about now. We're rocking about 3 inches before each way.
And you've made it solid now, have you? You've made it solid?
Oh, aye, yeah. Be there when we're all dead.
Oh.
It's a good job now.
Well, what height is that cross, Fred?
How high is it?
What height is it, yes?
It's about... It's about 4 feet tall altogether.
4 foot?
Yeah. Oh. And about 6 inches square.
Looks more than that from down here.
Yeah, but it's 400 weight, 300 weight. Well, there's no way it's going to fall down no more.
Well, from here, it looks as if you've made a solid job.
Oh, and it's all right now. And all spires pointed and everything.
It'll be here for another couple hundred years, will it? It'll be there for a couple of hundred years.
Oh, easy.
Good.
What are you worrying about?
Well, I'm worried about falling on somebody's head.
It'll last a good while longer, I can tell you.
Very good.
How's that? Oh. It'll never fall down. Right. fixed up the new stone pillars, complete with the copper dowels and everything, and we arrived the other day to have a look at the bell, and like the sort of skyline in the cemetery had changed, you know. And God, you know, about 24 gravestones been cocked over and smashed to pieces, you know. It's about £10,000 worth of damage, you know. What sort of people are these who can come around and shove over things like that that have been stood there for 100 years and just smash them to pieces, you know? They're evidently more than children, you know, for shove a stone over like that. You know, in the stages of early manhood, the thing is that they're either out of work and very unhappy and have a grudge against society as, you know, as we did know it, you know, all nice and peaceful and proper. And, you know, they just want to disrupt everything that they can bloody lay their hands on that's disruptible, you know. Like, why, you know, have we gone like this now? Because things were really bad in the 1930s, you know. People were actually hungry. You know, none of these people are hungry and have no bloody shoes. And yet them fellas in 1930, they didn't do it, did they? Sort of, you know, I don't know. The thing is, they lived in a world full of bloody fear. They knew if they did the wrong thing, it'd be trouble. And now they have no fear of anything, you know. I mean, I think we've definitely gone too bloody soft. You know, without a doubt. I mean, poor little Johnny couldn't help it. You know, he's under a lot of stress and this, that, and the other. I mean, bloody Ayatollah, if you pinch a loaf of bread there, like, bang, you know, it's the whole finger off, you know. And I think if they did a bit of that here, like, things would be a bit straighter. I mean, Isle of Man. The vandalism there, when they had the birch, were, I believe, you know, this is only what I've read in papers, were practically non-existent. And now, you know, the wonderful bloody common market job, they've been stopped using it. You know, I can't do it no more, you know, because the common market says so. You know, it'll never get any better until they bloody fire them into line, you know, like National Service or something like that. But, I mean, there's all these arguments against it. But the people who argue against it never come up with a bloody solution, do they? Never. You know, it just goes steadily worse day by day. So what can you do? You know, there's a lot to be said for the olden days, I say, you know, and how they did things. You were better craftsmen, you know, better at everything, really. Had more respect for property and things of that nature. Now they have no respect for nothing. You know, all they want is a life of bloody pleasure. Difficult.
Next Thursday at the same time, Fred Dibnah reflects on the transience of fame and fortune.